It's the most wonderful time of the year. Look up and you'll see shapes of V's and many other kind of checkmark shapes of flying geese, birds, and many other species. Look around in the trees and you'll see many species that are smaller that are only around the winter time. Migrations and weather are related to what we're flying over today. We're going to be discussing bird migration and how the weather affects it.
It's the happiest season of all. With those holiday greetings and gay happy meetings when friends come to call. It's the happiest season of all.
So the migration season is in the spring and the mid to late fall. Those are two separate ones. So generally birds fly in the mid to late fall down probably south in most situations to get to the warmer climate, because they like to be in more of a summertime climate. And then in the early spring is when they fly a little bit further north, and that's when they can get more, you know, food and things, and that will allow most of them to spread out. And that's obviously just to keep the same similar type of temperatures, and that's where they are used to living in. And though this can be changed actually by anomalies in the climate, so from temperatures to precipitation, actually birds can change when and how they migrate. We will look at some of the most migratory birds that fly the furthest, and some actually travel quite a ways to get to their temporary destination, to be where they're going to stay. And so starting out, we have the Canadian goose. Yes, these annoying birds take 12 years to cross the road. Everyone knows sitting behind them, they take forever. And why are they protected in America? Well, this is weird. So migratory birds are protected under federal bilateral migratory bird treaties the United States entered into with Great Britain. For Canada, it was 1916, as amended in 1999. They are known for their migratory lengths in almost every country they're in. They travel all the way across the country. Canadian geese are federally protected by the Act because they are listed as migratory birds in all four treaties. Because the Canadian goose is covered in all four, regulations must meet the requirements of the most restrictive of the four. So, since we all have the same treaty with these other countries that are around, and China's in there too, maybe it's Japan, I forget, but the other countries have different regulations, so they take the most strict of those, since we're all on the same treaty, and they apply all of the most strict of them, so, you know, one country doesn't get mad at another. So, overall, that's why there are so many strict rules and laws, and that's why if you hit one, that's a big problem, and if you kill one, that's even a bigger problem. And there's all these crazy things because other countries have different protective laws over migratory species. So that's why the goose is protected here in America, is because we're in on that treaty. And most, I think there's only one or two countries that aren't in the treaty that have Canadian geese. But other than that, I mean, these geese and migratory birds are protected in the countries where they are. And this goes for almost all migratory birds. I think there are some that have different laws for different types of birds, and there are exceptions in certain situations. Like in many places, there is actually a hunting season for them. I don't think in Canada there is, but in America there is a hunting season. It is a very small window. I think it is either a month or maybe even less than a month. But that's why, you know, it's so strict, is because we have to go by the most restrictive of all four to be able to keep the treaty and keep everyone happy.
Caroling out in the snow, there'll be scary ghost stories and tales of the glories of.
And that's from the Federal Register. I will have the link in the description for that, so you can go check it out. It's under the Migratory Birds Permits and Regulations for the goose population. So in many places, they don't migrate too far, but there are geese all over the country. So that makes you think, well, they had to travel some distance. Well, they do actually. Many you see are actually traveling many miles. You will see them flying over cornfields and things that are, you know, they're in the middle of nowhere. So obviously they have to go somewhere. So Canadian geese fly at an average of about 40 mile per hour. So when migrating, they might actually increase that speed because, you know, they're flying in those V's and those checkmark-like shapes. And you've seen this probably before, whether it was in some movie or you just read it in class once. But they fly that way to be more aerodynamic. And what happens is they take turns leading the pack, if you want to call it that. I think there is actually a name for them. But they have a system that they fly in to make them more aerodynamic. It saves energy. It allows them to go faster. And they actually take turns moving up to the front and moving to the back. So what happens is when a goose in the front gets tired, it flies to the back. Then the one that was second moves up, and you keep doing that all the way till your destination. And excuse me, that is actually what a lot of I think fighter pilots can do that too. Ones that you know, that was a military strategy back when planes didn't have as much fuel, was fly aerodynamic and then take turns pooling. That is a lot of cyclists do that too. You know, it's Tour de France, and many of them, they take turns going in the front, and then other people get in the draft, the space behind them, where air resistance is less, allowing everyone to save fuel, energy, and go faster. So increasing the 70 mile per hour, if they catch a tailwind especially, that will let them go that fast. But that means, you know, you're flying 70 miles in an hour. I mean, that's, you can fly across a state, most states, than in a few hours. So it really allows them to travel a great distance. So that's why you see them all over the country, is because they can fly at these great speeds. Migrations can last as long as 2,000 to 3,000 miles. That is a lot. That is like the distance across the entire U.S. And geese are capable of flying up to a 1,500 miles in a single day if the weather is good. If they're on a tailwind, obviously, they might be able to fly a little bit further. And or if they get caught in a pressure system, that will actually let them be able to, you know, fly a little bit further. And that's from the AmericanExpedition.us. So another bird species is the hummingbird, and this is kind of funny in my opinion, because, you know, they're small. You see them kind of buzzing around a little bit, you see them kind of flying all the way around, you see them just messing around in one little area. They're quick and small, but actually, you don't think that they couldn't travel that far, and it's amazing, but you're actually wrong if you think that. These birds travel a great distance. So, many hummingbirds spend the winter in Central America or Mexico and migrate north to their breeding grounds in the southern U.S. as early as February. To areas further north later in the spring, hummingbirds fly by day when nectar sources and such as flowers are more abundant. So, you know, when the sun comes out, you know, the flowers, they actually turn to see the sun and everything, and that allows them to get to open up a bit more and see some more, and it allows them to kind of take in more light, and that's for growth and color and everything, and that also allows the nectar to be produced at a faster rate. So these hummingbirds, you know, you see them flying around flowers, plants, and all that. They will fly during the day to these and get them because there's so much of it. It's kind of like bees.
When loved ones are near, it's the most wonderful time of the year. There'll be parties for hosts of marshmallows and toast, and caroling out in the snow. There'll be scary ghost stories and tales of the glories of Christmas is long, long ago. It's the most wonderful time of the year. There'll be much mistletoeing and hearts will be glowing when loved ones are near. It's the most wonderful time. Yes, the most wonderful time. Oh, the most wonderful time of the year.
So looking at all this, you might be wondering, what does any of this have to do with the weather? So, looking at a map, the most common is the Anna hummingbird, and these are out of the hummingbirds. This is a photo I have from online. Not only are they south, but they go quite a ways into Canada. So these birds are traveling across the entire country, north, south and north, just to get to their destination. And I will have a link to the photo. It's from hummingbirdcentral.com. And this photo shows the spring 2019 migration map. And the key for it says that the Annas are the red ones. And looking at them, they are kind of all over. They go from Los Angeles all the way up into British Columbia. And another one, and this is kind of amazing, is the ruby-throated hummingbird. And this one is, the map is covered anywhere from, it's actually kind of split right down the middle of the country. Anything to the east has like nothing but ruby birds. And they go from Florida all the way up to Wisconsin, Ohio, New York, Maine, New Hampshire, all of New England. And they actually go up into some of the mid portions of Alberta, Canada, and Saskatchewan, probably about right in the middle of that. And that you get see a few of them up in Ontario and Quebec, and a few in the Newfoundland, and some in Nova Scotia. So a lot of them, they're heavily condensed on the eastern coast is where you see the most of them. But looking across, I mean, the half the U.S. is covered in them, and there are a few I see over. Utah has one species of it. There's some in Arizona. West Texas. I think there's one in Washington. I might just be seeing a different color though, but there are some in Montana. So you see this big migratory pattern. And so they're all flying from Mexico and Central America all the way up through the entire eastern part of the US. So it's crazy to see these tiny birds that are the size of the palm of your hands are flying that long. And I honestly, I've never seen a group of them before. I have only seen one or two. So they obviously they are independent, some of the ones, especially the ones up in Canada where they're more spread out, in North of South Dakota where they're more spread out. But the ones that are heavily condensed, they will fly in groups. So that's what allows, different types of hummingbirds to be so abundant in areas. And so looking at a few other ones, there's some ones that are in southeastern Texas. There are the buffed belly ones. Let me see. There's the Rivolis that are in southeastern Arizona. What else is there? There is the Allens. They are in California and parts of Oregon. And then the other one are the Rufous ones. And these ones will go. Wow, this is actually kind of interesting. So they start out. There are a few species in Arizona and the western part of New Mexico, and they go all the way up through Utah, Nevada, California, up through Oregon, Washington, and there are a few in Montana, but they even go up into Alberta. But this is where it gets interesting. There are a few species along the coast of British Columbia. So actually, looking in, let me zoom in on this. There is one, I believe, in Alaska. It is the most southeastern point in Alaska. There is a single hummingbird species of Rufous. So that's quite interesting. And I mean, looking around, there are plenty more. There's like the broad-tailed ones. They're all over Utah, Colorado, Wyoming. Calliope are all over the Rockies. Black-chinned also all over the Rockies and the kind of Death Valley part of California. And there's Costas. Where are those at? Oh, so this is interesting. So Costas made me think that they're gonna be coastal, but no, they're in the southern tip of Nevada. So those are just some of the examples. There are some unknown ones that are in southern and southern east and eastern parts of Arizona and Nevada. So they're kind of on the tips of both of those. The northeast part of, or not the northeast, northwest part of Arizona, and then the southeastern part of Arizona also has them. Sorry, I have these on two different pages. And so that and all that information is from hummingbirdcentral.com. I'll have a link for that. So one last bird we're looking at is the Arctic tern. And this bird is fascinating. They fly the farthest of any bird, and it's kind of amazing. They are actually quite small, maybe the size of a blue jay. And so they aren't any big bird. They're not going to be like a heron that they can get a little bit more distance because of their great size. They fly 3 times the distance from the Earth to the Moon in its lifetime. Now that's a long way. So right after this, we are going to check out how exactly they fly and what their deal is, and then what the weather is going to do to them. This bird sees more daylight than any other bird. So the Arctic tern, like many birds, flies great distances every year to maintain its life of endless summertime. So it's a different type of situation, though, because it flies, it's used to the cold and everything, but it likes a certain amount of cold, so they don't want to be frozen in the middle of darkness forever, whenever the Earth, you know, tilts to where, you know, there's almost no sunlight up there for most of the day. They like to have some daylight, so they will actually, they breed on the north shores of the Arctic Ocean in the northern hemisphere summer, and it feeds over the ocean to the southern hemisphere half a year later. So half the year they're in the southern hemisphere, probably down South Africa, maybe about that latitude, and then maybe about, I think it's the North Arctic Ocean area, you know, where the Arctic Ocean kind of takes like a cut into the Arctic itself, and that's where most of these birds will breed and everything. So they will fly over the equator and back at a high altitude, and they spend most of their time flying. They spend almost their entire time flying, and that's where they feed, is in the southern hemisphere. So the North American Arctic tern flies about 24,000 miles, which is 40,000 kilometers each year. That's a distance about equal around the Earth. So basically, every year, it flies around the whole Earth. So an Arctic tern can live up for 25 years. So it's in its lifelong quest for summer. So it can fly 1,000,000 kilometers, which is 620,000 miles in 25 years. That's crazy. That's like how much a car would get if you drive to work every single day. Imagine that, nonstop, though, for 25 years. And it honestly just keeps adjusting, and it does whatever it wants. This bird sure does get some views. Talk about a world traveler, here's your bird. And that's from earthsky.org / earth, and that is a bird article that they wrote. And it's crazy. So birds normally try to stay where the weather is warm, so they migrate to warmer climates. When one place gets cold, they just fly to another place that's a little bit warmer. So, you know, with global warming, that's actually going to be disrupted. And these birds are now staying in the same place, and that is a problem. A big, big problem. So we're looking at ecosystems that are going to be completely messed up. I mean, not only are you having the birds that are normally going to be there because they want that summertime, you're going to end up with the birds that are, you know, trying to migrate to different places for different climates. Because of climate change, the area itself is going to change. And so you're actually going to end up with more of different species in the same area. And ecosystems do have a limit. That is something that many, many, many biologists will tell you, and there is evidence to back that up. Parts of the world can only sustain so many animals, and that, you know, different species eat different types of plants, foods, even other animals. But if you get multiple species in the same place, some are going to adapt, and when those species adapt, they're going to be eating different types of plants and fruits that are in that area. And what's going to end up happening is we're going to have a lack of whatever plant or whatever is in that area, and we will see species start to die off. And, you know, when they start dying off, they're going to not have the food. So they're either going to have to adapt, or we're going to see more extinctions. So, you know, a big thing in the news right now is the, you know, animal extinctions and saving animals, saving ecosystems, big places in the South, I think Louisiana, Alabama, some of them are doing them. They're setting up coral reefs that not only are for the animals, but they actually protect us humans. I mean, as the Earth kind of breaks away, we are running out of a protection. And many of these places are going to have a lack of these resources. And what's going to end up happening, we're going to lose these. And I mean, that seems like it's a big problem for the animals, but that's going to in turn go right to us. Because if these animals adapt, we're going to see a massive drop in the berry populace. There's going to be little amounts of berries left. And, you know, blue jays and cardinals, they eat a lot of red berries. And, I mean, if they have to adapt, let's just say, to eat red raspberries, we're just going to say, since it's on the topic of red, what's going to happen is all of these birds are going to be eating food that we need. And when there's all these birds in a small area, just imagine the amount of problems with it. I mean, funny enough with this, I mean, you're going to have a problem. There's going to be bird poop everywhere. But, I mean, that's the least of your problem. You're going to have trees that are breaking, and then that's going to be hitting power lines because there are so many birds on them. Birds are going to be breaking power lines. And you're going to end up having all of these different types of animals. We will see a growth in populations that eat birds. You're gonna see like multiple, I think, dog species, so wolves in them that can catch some birds. You're going to see a decrease in a lot of the carnivores will be fine, but some omnivores, and then some of those animals that are going to only eat vegetables or certain types of berries. You're going to see a drop in those species because all of these birds and other species that are staying in the same place and not migrating are going to be eating all of the food for the other animals. And we're going to see a drop in all of that, and that is going to directly affect us because we're going to see deaths in many populations of different species. And so we're going to be wiping out many of the types of animals that you're used to seeing. And I mean, with the average of I believe it's 1.5 degrees in on average of higher temperatures, I believe it's every decade, you're going to see all of these animals that are used to colder climates going to the poles, and you're going to lose all of them. You're not going to see them ever again. So a great example with this is the polar bear. Everyone keeps talking about how if we keep CO2 emissions up, that we're going to see the extinction of polar bears. And it's not because polar bears can't handle it, that we are melting the ice that they need to live on. And that leads us to bears in general. You're going to see many bear species that are not hibernating anymore. So not only are you changing how the animal lives and where it's at, you're changing how the animal is alive. You're changing its regular patterns. You are changing the patterns that have been going back since the start of the species. And most of these are so they can just, you know, live out through the winter and stuff and, you know, hibernate and everything. So you're going to see these types of berries and different animals and stuff that they go and like hunt at the end of the fall before they go into hibernation. They're gonna have a growth because they will not be as attacked and eaten as much because the bears won't need them. And all these hibernating species, types of squirrels and things that all rely on the same type of food, they're going to be around. And so, I mean, you're going to see increases in many of these populations, and really, no one wants that. It'd be kind of cool to see, but that's something you don't want to be happening around your home. And it's great to see more animals, but you have to note, too, those same animals are the ones that are making it. The amount of animals that will not make it, the ones that will go extinct, will be extraordinarily high. It will be exponentially getting higher and higher and higher of how many animals we are putting on the extinction watch. There are many right now that are actually on it that are quite normal animals, and we will see losses in many of the bigger bird populations because if the little birds all eat the same thing and they all die off then because, you know, there's no food left in the area and they haven't been migrating for X amount of time, these bigger birds that eat the smaller birds won't have any food. So we're going to have to see either an adaptation in some big birds like eagles or hawks and even crows. Or we're going to see extinction in many of those. Bald eagles are on the extinction watch right now. They are not the highest. There are different tiers of extinction watches. They are not on the highest one, but they're up there because there are not that many. And that is a direct correlation of humanity. When we moved in, you know, that population drops. Cut down trees, they don't have bigger trees for nests. So it's a problem. And looking at all these examples, you can see why. It's quite interesting to see what humanity has done. So, I mean, looking at the rest of them, adaptation is really going to be the future. Everyone keeps talking about, yeah, we'll be fine, we're just going to go ahead and try to fix all this. It's not that simple. You're going to have to fix a lot. And looking at all this in the whole picture of Earth, Earth is massive. We are not fixing all of it anytime soon. We're going to keep creating more, which will double, and we will only be able to get the amount that's currently out there, but since it's doubling, we will have a struggle to get all that done. And when, you know, this is kind of like deficit spending, you can make $100, but if you're spending $200, you're not having any money. So the same thing, analogy applies to Earth. If you're pumping out so much CO2, let's say you're doing 200 parcels of CO2, and you can only clean up 100 of it, you're doubling for every one you get. So that's a problem. Those ratios are not good. We're going to see, along with all this, we're going to see a decrease in A, amount of migratory birds, because many won't need to move, and B, the distance those travel. So the Arctic tern, that's going to be a whole separate issue, because they're reliant on those colder temperatures and ice in the oceans and frozen areas in the Arctic, Antarctica, all those places. But the birds that don't really need all that much to move, I mean, they can stay around a little bit longer. And so we're going to see a lot of differences, and really the face of the Earth is going to be changed. And I mean, the common theme here is that things and animals are going to have to adapt. Many plants are going to have to change. They're going to have to be a lot of big trees might be able to keep their leaves year round. And it's one of those things, you can see it in a greenhouse effect, you could see it in the tropics. Imagine that everywhere, though. And you got that humidity, and we're going to see a lot of problems whenever all this happens. And when a migratory bird decides it's time to migrate, hormonal changes trigger biological preparations, such as increased fat deposition, which makes the long trip easier. Migrations are heaviest from April to May and late August into early October. An internal compass composed of the ethmoid bone, working with a fifth pair of cranial nerves, gives birds a sense called magnetorception. The ability to perceive the electromagnetic fields of Earth allows them to travel vast distances in a virtually straight line. So that's how Earth's magnet field is kind of affecting birds, and that's how they know where to fly. You always think about that. How do they always end up in the same spot? Well, that's because they know. And I mean, that straight line is quite interesting. And you know, there's something, you know, you see the aurora borealis, you know, all that stuff, they're really cool, but that's little changes in Earth's magnetic field, and those are little atoms that are escaping, and it's quite interesting to see all those, but that could actually be a problem. And looking at, you know, this is where meteorology applies to all of this. You see a high pressure system or a low pressure system, and you're changing how the magnetic field works. And it's interesting to see, you know, there are actually live examples, and we'll get to this in a little bit, on radar of, you know, storms and birds getting stuck inside of them. And you'll see, you know, they'll come up in the middle of the day in lows and high depression systems, and some low coastal systems will get all those coastal birds to think, oh yeah, it's time to go, and you'll see them flying. So, you know, not only do you have the problem of, you know, birds and storms, obviously that's a little bit of a problem, but it's you're going to have a problem with almost every bird whenever you consider more lightning. Because lightning are little atoms literally exploding. They are breaking and exploding, and that's where the light comes out of it and the sound and everything. Because it's a combustion process. And that is changing the magnetic field too. Because every time that happens, there's going to be a little pulse. And that pulse is going to change it either, it's going to bump it up, it's going to either knock it to the side. So you're changing a little bit. So if there are birds flying over the storm, no matter how high up it is, they're going to be changed direction a little bit, changed a little more, and they're going to follow that. And that signal is going to pull them off. And a quite interesting statistic is that more than half migrants are believed to not return home because they either perish, largely due to malignant weather, and abundance of predators in warmer climates, including humans. So over half of the birds are not coming back, and that's a problem. And that's where malignant weather comes in. You see hurricanes are the biggest example of this, messing birds up, and that's not a good thing to see. And the best migration weather is whatever conditions favor moderately strong tailwinds, so pushing the bird. Birds can ride the winds churned by low pressure systems, but prefer the great conditions that tend to accompany high pressure systems. So, I mean, these pressure systems are not a problem, but the storms themselves created by them are. Because they are flying, some of these birds fly at such an altitude that storms aren't there. They are higher than some of the clouds, like cumulonimbus, that are, you know, going to affect them. And it's kind of interesting that, you know, such a small thing, like a lightning bolt that's in a single spot, can change a whole migratory pattern. And, you know, these tailwinds, if they're going to headwinds, they have no chance because, you know, that's a lot of hard work. And that they will get all off track and everything, and they have to focus on where they're going. And weather hazards may alter migration behaviors by lengthening or shortening legs of the trip. So that's actually a problem because, you know, those senses that they have will tell them how long and how far. Well, if there's an excessive wind one day, a tailwind, that will get them there faster. That's the problem, though. They're getting there faster, so they don't know that they're there. So you're going to see displacement of many species. And that's all, you know, ecosystem problems. Because, I mean, birds can live in many different places. They can adapt to it. I mean, there's not even that much adaptation needs to happen here in North America. I mean, you have a lot of the same plants in different parts of the country and of the continent. But when you see, you know, birds thousands of miles off trail, that's a problem. If you have a bird that's used to, let's just say, big redwood trees in California, and they end up in Maine, where there are rocks and oak trees and all these random other types of plants that they have no idea what they are. And, I mean, big things like that can kill birds, that we will see extinctions because of that. And a reduced visibility induced by fog is likely to drive migrations to a halt. So you're stopping migrations, and if there is a lot of bad fog, you will be stuck in it for a few weeks. Even general precipitation and counterproductive but normal wind speeds can disrupt migrations. That's all pushing off, changing the magnetic field. Notable winds can blow them off course, causing a wind drift migration, which is known to make especially coastal birds tire out, fall, and drown. So this is the sad reality of wind, and is with the coastal birds. Many of them are flying over a certain area, you know, they're flying, they're migrating, they're doing their thing, and then a heavy wind gust blows, and they try to correct it, and, you know, they try to work with that sensor and everything and try to keep it going, but then they're just gonna fall because they'll tire out. And ones that like to fly over the ocean, especially ones that fly from maybe the eastern coast of Florida up to Maine, who don't take any time really, because they can fly that fast, they don't take any time to, you know, stop. And so they think that they're getting there in a certain amount of time. They're not. So they'll tire out, and then they'll fall. And many birds can't swim. You can see ducks and stuff, that, you know, they paddle their little webbed feet. That's it. I mean, a lot of these coastal birds are used to sitting on rocks or on the beach, not in the water. And even ones that do, you know, dive for fish in the water, they fly back out. They don't just float along, so they'll tire out and they'll hit the water pretty hard. Considering they're thousands of feet up in the air, even maybe a mile or two, that's a problem. And it's kind of crazy, you know, you see birds diving down in, but those birds are meant to do that. That's not a good thing for these birds. And Hurricane Matthew pushed northward along Florida. Everyone remembers Matthew with its strength and everything. And a flock was widely believed to have been caught in the eye of the storm. You know, the stadium effect. You've seen the photos. It's crazy. But birds get stuck in this. And the signature was likely from larger birds with winds exceeding 120 mile per hour. And the torrential rains were just constant in this. And so there is a photo I have on here of it. It is probably maybe 20 miles or so northeast of Melbourne and Palm Bay, Florida. It is east, directly east of Orlando. And there is a picture of the eye, and on the photo on the right, which is the differential reflectivity, you see all these red dots in the bottom of the eye. You can still see the eye, but you see all these red and yellow. And looking at the super res reflectivity tilt one that is on the left, you were looking at a photo where, you know, all that blue in the bottom below where all the precipitation is, there's not all that much there, but that's actually the problem. Looking on the right, you're going to see, you know, the differential reflectivity is debris getting lofted up in the air. So the fact that you see that many dots, that's either an entire city flying away, which is, like, horrible, which did not happen, considering it, well, yeah, that definitely didn't happen, because that was over the water. Or those are all birds, and those poor birds are getting stuck, they're thrown around, there's probably no chance that they made it, but it's interesting to see on that, you know, with a storm with an eye such as this, and the amount of strength and velocity that this thing had, that it sucked in birds. It's like a tornado, it's a massive tornado, basically, and this thing sucked in all the birds, and now they are stuck. And that photo is from weatherops.com, and that is a photo I got from there. So overall, migration is based on many factors. Global warming is definitely changing migration. It is a major problem that we need to look into and try to fix. And a lot of people have great ideas, and I mean, we're doing them right now, and it's helping a lot. Stronger weather systems are altering birds' courses back home, and that is changing ecosystems, and that is changing how the face of our Earth looks, and a lot of people are going to be seeing changes like these in the future. You are already seeing a lot of summer birds stick around into the late fall months, which doesn't happen normally, but the weather, warmer weather is going to allow that to happen. Hurricanes and other systems can kill birds, and radar captures many of these events as they happen. Many birds get stuck in these, and for birds and other animal species, they have to find a way to hide. And when they're migrating, especially in some of these months in the middle of hurricane season, they're going to get stuck, and a lot of bad things will happen. But that's all related to the overall, you know, global warming climate change issue. And I mean, we are coming up with some good ideas, and we need to keep applying them. My favorite thing of this entire climate change campaign that's currently going on is what we're doing with the ecosystems in the swamps and different coastal regions. They are allowing great events and different types of outings that people go and volunteer, and they help out, they bring new species there. There are many in Jamaica that are, there's a whole foundation down there that is putting up new coral reefs. And while I was on a trip to Hawaii in the late summer this year, there was quite an interesting situation that they had going on there, and a plan to build up coral reefs. What they do is they stick some cinder blocks out in the middle, probably about 100 yards offshore, and I was kind of doing some snorkeling around them and everything, and got some cool video of it. But they had all these cinder blocks, and there was some coral growing off of it, some seaweed, fish were living in there and everything. And it's great to see that all these are coming together. There are many good ocean projects right now. Four Oceans there. There are many other ones that I'm not thinking of right now, but, you know, everyone's working, and everyone is trying to help out, and it's good. And plastic cleanup is definitely helping. But, you know, any small steps help. So it's definitely an interesting topic. And if you're interested in that, that is a big field right now. And that will be a big field for the next maybe century. So get into it. If you're interested in it, you can help out, volunteer, or go to school for it, you know, study it. It's quite interesting, and there's so much behind all of these fields that meteorology is involved with, and, you know, science and everything is what's going to give us some of the answers on what to do right now in long term. And, you know, with improvements and all that in technology, it's allowing the field of science to really grow. It's allowing us to see more and help more, and knowledge is helping people all over the world. And so we're gonna see an overall change, and I mean, they could come up with these great plans for ecosystems, and all the world's ecosystems need to be in order, and we're disrupting it. It's amazing to see what effect we have on the overall climate of the world. And by the end of this century, it would be amazing to see stuff be lowered, maybe even cut in half. And to see the world then compared to now, electric-powered things will be a lot more prevalent. They'll be a lot more prevalent. And electric is much better. You know, you're not taking up fossil fuels. You can use electric for a lot of stuff, and you can create it cheap and everything. So it's amazing. And it'll be great to see what people can do in the future with this. So I want to thank you again for listening, and check out some of our other episodes. It's amazing what we could see in research, and yeah, it's December and everything, so hope you enjoyed some of the Christmas music that was going on throughout this, and I am super excited to see what 2020 will bring. It seems 2020's election for President of the United States is going to be quite interesting. So we're going to see what changes we'll see. I mean, really, though, it doesn't happen to 2021. But we're going to see what is going to be happening and what new ideas are going to be going on and everything. And we'll see by then, you know, who knows what a year out from now the Earth will look like. Maybe we'll have some new systems. Inventions are being invented every single day. So the world is changing every minute of every day, and you never know what can happen next. So thank you so much again for watching, and we'll hope to see you next time.